哲文的好朋友们，大家晚安。因为今天这个场子很热络，人很多，那我们要保持哲武的这个优良的自我介绍的这个传统，所以我必须要提早有几分钟开始哦。那我是今天的这一场的主持人黄台，我本身也是台师大英语系的老师，台师大也有哲武的活动，请大家上一下粉专给我按赞，然后注意一下相关的一些讯息。那我们今天很高兴邀请到Lauren Saito 来帮我们主讲，他同时也是那本书《打破神话》的作者。那语坛人是我们张国成，国成老师应该很多人都认识，大家也可以掌声鼓励。谢谢。那我们也是非常非常尽责的一个帮我们做即席翻译的嘉宏同学，他好像也是我们师大同学，掌声鼓励一下。谢谢。今天这个主题非常重要，很高兴看到这么多朋友非常关心这个重要这个主题。那么从一个最简单的一个层次开始谈所谓的殖民体制，你可能从历史上可以翻到说它可能跟航海的发现有关，跟军事武力取得统治权，那它可能是透过战争割地赔款然后取得土地统治权。那就法理上来讲的话，我们会说如果有一个政权它是没有经过被统治者的这个认可，从外地搬了一个整个这个宪法或者是统治这个体制到另外一个地方，这个已经有符合殖民体制的这样一个基本的一个定义。那除此之外，殖民主义还有一个很重要的一个就是经济剥削的这个目的吧。那它当然也有一些更细腻的一些可能跟思想操控洗脑有关的一些行为，包括说像通过教育啊，通过一些文化的政策来施行所谓的这个殖民主义。那我们现在这个主题其实还有另外一个很重要的，应该是可能是大家更关心的是说去殖民或者解殖民的这个问题啦。那当然解殖民去殖民化可以通过很多种不同的这种方式嘛，可以透过武力的抗争革命之类的哦，然后也可以经过比较漫长的一段文化启蒙或者是民族国家意识的这种觉醒，这个累积的过程感觉上是比较漫长一点的。大家看一看这过去的这一两个世纪里面，实际上这个世界上已经有好几波的这种推翻殖民体制建立一个新的民族国家的几波的这个运动。那可能最早一点大家会联想到就是美国，那除此之外还有中南美洲，在到20世纪之后有说法亚洲的国家跟非洲的一些国家都经历过在这几波的这个解殖民成立新的民主国家里面，都是引起世界这种注意。这一系列名单里面好像少了一个国家，那这个国家可能就是我们今天特别关心的台湾的这个解殖民的这个问题的哈。那这个历史的部分我就不多说了。在艾森老师先生开始演讲之前，国成老师这边要先帮大家解释一下今天的这个活动的这个目的哈。我们就把时间交给国成老师。
好，今天的真欢喜吼，会当接到艾森先生吼来这边演讲。讲实在，今年以前吼，我唔敢想讲会当有这个机会吼，吼拄到伊吼，吼这个我心内一种吼，感觉真正是台湾上需要知影的人。吼，我10年以前吼，读到伊的册，读到伊的文章吼，迄时阵台湾国一篇报纸叫《台湾日报》，这个Mr. Iden 的文章吼，吼拢伫遐有刊。我感觉这真正是台湾爱读的文章，为伊的文章内底吼，我读到啥？我读到温暖，我读到关怀，我读到理智，我读到坚强。哦，所以讲呢，而且我了解一个真正上重要的问题。这问题是啥呢？就是讲嘛，真正爱解决台湾的问题吼，唔是靠一两摆、五年、十年的社会运动，甚至唔是靠一摆、两摆的选举的胜利，甚至靠政党的问题，靠的是啥？靠的是爱解决台湾的殖民主义。解除台湾的殖民的状态，我感觉这是上重要的物件吼。哦，台湾一定要来解决殖民者带来的问题，然后咧，殖民者加强维护伊个殖民吼所建立的国防限制。哦，我想这是上重要的。因为在座咧，我知影有中国来的朋友吼， 吼，可能无法度听完全听有台语吼，但是时间的关系，我就无用北京语讲一遍，我用英语讲。I'm very honored to recommend Mr. Eichmann's articles. Yeah, his articles showed a warm concern and sincere anxiety about Taiwan's future, and a great sympathy towards the people of this island. His writing are like words of wisdom and enlightening advice for a loyal and well-wished friend, providing a useful food for those who really care.For the future of Taiwan's democracy. In Taiwan, generations of Taiwanese have been successfully brainwashed about their cultural and historical link with China only. The government, ROC government, teaches Taiwanese to identify the history, culture, values of their country. It is almost a textbook case of colonialism.Taiwan is paying the price for its self-defeating interpretation on the issue of independence is a weak idea of national identity. I'm very honored to host this item to give us this speech. I wish this excellent speech can encourage the Taiwanese to prevent the future of Taiwan as a post-colonial society. The colonialism is a question that we must notand cannot evade at this stage of Taiwan's political development. In the future, I wish we can create a new national myth. Taiwan needs a national myth of its own instead of those imposed upon by the Republic of China. It's my dream. I hope everyone has this dream. In fact, we should work hard to make our dream come true, otherwise it will become a daydream.At the same time, I hope everyone has this goal in mind, and because the goal is the first step to success. That's all. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Yeah, forgive me while I try and make the various bits of technology work here. Now, let's see. How does this work?
Does that work? Oh, it works. There you go. Right, as I say, so.Basically, I've got a microphone in this hand and an iPad in this hand, and I need a third hand to actually move my speech. Anyway, good evening.
Good evening.
Now, first, I'd just like to say how flattered I am that you should come here today to hear my probably rather superficial thoughts on some journalistic work which is now 12 or 13 years old. I think the original articles were done in 2002, 2003. Anyway, I was forced to reread these myself after all these years, and I was actually surprised by just how much I used to know about Taiwan. And I probably have to apologize right now if, after living away from Taiwan for 7.5 years, I don't seem to know as much about current events here as all of you obviously will.I'm also surprised to find that these essays still have some relevancy. I assume they do, since otherwise you wouldn't be here. The issues that they talk about sometimes seem rather distant from Taiwan, such as I have seen it on my recent visits. But I guess you're better judges of that. In the foreword of the book, I explain something about the development of my thinking.Now, when I arrived in Taiwan, which was in July 1986, I was not a Chinese scholar. I wasn't a scholar at all. I was an itinerant 20-something trying to get as far away as possible from a disastrous love affair in London. I know it sounds like a movie. It isn't a movie. Looking for a place to stay.
看到各位前来聆听我十二三年前新闻工作的一些浅见，我真的感到受宠若惊。多年后的今天，我被迫要回头看我当年写的文章，但看了之后，我蛮惊讶的发现，其实当年我对台湾真的了解的蛮深刻的。而且，我想跟大家说个抱歉，因为我距离上次来台湾已经是大概7年半之前了，我住台湾已经这么久了。 所以对于时事，我想各位应该比我更了解。此外，令我惊讶的另外一件事情就是，我当年写的文章现在还算适用。当然，就是因为适用，大家才会来听我讲。那其实近年来，我有造访几次台湾，但是我发现，在这边发生的一些事情，跟我当年写的东西还是有一点点距离。可是大家的评判是比较准的，这方面是比较准的。在书中的前言当中呢，我大概解释了一下我思想的发展历程。我第一次来台湾是1980年7月，当时我根本不算是个学者，只是一个中流雁国的20刚刚岁的年轻人，只是想要尽可能的离开伦敦来填一填情感的伤口而已。
So, when I arrived in Taiwan, as I said, in 1986, the place that I found was totally unlike the one that I had been led to expect. Now, Taiwan was touted in the West as being a repository of traditional Chinese culture that had otherwise been destroyed in China. Anyway, as I was saying, now, I'm not sure what I expected to find, but I thought it would be something like out of a scene of Lao Tzu's play Tea House. But of course, Taiwan in the mid-80s was nothing like this, and after a while, I was quite dissatisfied. I remember one of my Taiwanese friends commenting that I seemed permanently upset that Taiwan Chinese didn't seem Chinese enough. Somehow, I developed a taste for May 4th movement literature. And of course, I didn't expect to find much in translation in Taiwan. And I satisfied my interest by buying mainland or Hong Kong translations on visits to Hong Kong. Then, having read and enjoyed the writings of these writers like Lao Tzu, Yu Shu, Shen Tongwen, Mao Dun, and others, I wanted to talk about them with my Taiwanese friends. And then I found out that nobody in Taiwan had read them. How could this be, I wondered. Here's the output of the most important literary movement in China in the 20th century. Here am I in a state that claims to treasure the Chinese heritage. Here are well-educated people who claim to honor that heritage. And here's a yawning gap of knowledge. Actually felt like a missionary for May the 4th literature. Anyway, this awoke me to the idea that the traditional Chinese culture boasted about by the KMT regime at that time really was a kind of construct by the KMT, and a very limited one. In fact, it might even have been a fantasy. Now, at that time, I probably knew almost nothing about Taiwanese history, and it probably never occurred to me that, well, Taiwanese were being molded into loyal Japanese subjects in the 1920s. There was little interest in mainland Chinese literary movements. But this did awaken me to a gulf, a big gap, between what the KMT claimed about the culture here and the reality.
在1986年我来台湾的时候，我并不知道我该预期能够发现什么。当时在西方，大家都觉得说台湾是中华文化的正统继承者，毕竟中华文化在中国已经被消灭殆尽了。但是我不是那么确定我会看见什么，所以我当时想象说我可能会看到像老舍的戏剧《茶馆》当中的场景吧。但我来之后发现根本不是这么回事，也失望了好一阵子。我的台湾朋友还调侃说，可能台湾的中华文化不够中国吧。总之，我逐渐喜欢上了古色文学。那我也不预期在台湾能够找到中译本，英译本。反正我在中国、在香港出差的时候，都已经买到英译本，然后也够满足我了。在玩味老舍、鲁迅、沈从文跟茅盾等人的文字之余，其实我也蛮想分享这些文学作品给台湾朋友的。但我发现台湾朋友没有一个读过，全部都不知道。我就问自己，怎么会这样呢？古色文学是中国20世纪的很重大的文学运动，台湾又自称中华文化的正统继承者，台湾的知识分子也以中华文化为荣啊，怎么却都不知道五四文学呢？说的好像我在替五四文学传教一样，好烦。那我后来又意识到说，其实国民党政权当时所宣称夸耀的中华文化，就算不算是幻想好的，也顶多算是个有限度的架构而已。当时我对台湾的历史其实也不太了解，我也没有想到，其实在1920年代，五四 文学运动如火如荼展开的时候，其实台湾人正在被黄奴化。所以我就发现了，其实国民党宣称的文化价值与台湾当时的文化现况根本就有出入。
But my problem with Taiwan wasn't just literary, I should say. I mean, the obvious apparatus of state control at the tail end of dictatorship was all around. I remember being down at the Danshui River on the first double 10 day I was in Taiwan, so that would be October 1986. And I remember the announcements about what to do if, during the fireworks display, we were attacked by the mainland.And how most of the people in the young crowd laughed at this derisively. And over the next couple of years, it became very clear to me that we had a country with a political regime that was deeply at odds with the aspirations of most of its people. Of course, everybody wants prosperity and everybody wants security. There's no conflict there.How many people in Taiwan thought that the main aim of Taiwan society was to launch a base for retaking China? Somewhere along the line, I encountered the story of retrocession and 228, and this is a time when, if I asked my Taiwanese friends, they could tell me almost nothing about 228, by the way. The alienness of the regime and its lack of some kind of emotional linkage with the people it governed began to be very obvious. Now, you could attribute this to the results of dictatorship. I mean, by this I mean that dictatorships often have aims that are different from those of their subjects. But actually, one of the strange things that we do know about dictatorships is that they often carry significant popular support.Just because people didn't vote for a government, or more likely, didn't have a real choice in who they might vote for, doesn't mean they don't support its aims. What was striking about Taiwan in the later 1980s was the huge big gap, between the government position on almost everything and that of the people it governed.Now, I thought about this, and I mulled over the huge gaps between the thinking of the Taiwanese and the ethnic mainlanders I knew, and I was looking for some kind of tool that could explain what was going on here. There were two communities with almost entirely different values. There was a governing regime that in no way seemed to address popular aspirations, but instead promoted somethingso arcane and unbelievable at the time, retaking the mainland, as a slogan. How could this be?
但是台湾所面临的问题不只是文学而已，基本上国家机器还有独裁的影子随处可见。我还记得当年我第一次在台湾过双十节，也就是1986年的十月哦。那个时候我人在淡水。然后政府在国庆烟火释放到一半的时候说，哎，如果共军打来的话要怎么办怎么办，在宣布的时候在场的年轻人全部都是不屑的笑声。然后这个时候我就发现，而且此后的两年我也开始发现，其实这个政府跟民意是脱节的。当然人民最想要的是繁荣跟安全稳定，这点没有问题，但是人民又怎么样相信整个台湾的社会的主要的目的确实要反攻大陆呢？后来我再回头检视二二八事件还有光复，然后发现台湾人对二二八事件的始末一无所知，我就清楚地意识到，其实这个政权是个外来政权，跟所治理的人民其实没有什么心理上的连结。那么你可以把这一切归咎到独裁政治身上，我的意思是说，独裁政府的意识往往跟民意是相左的，没错，但妙的是独裁政府往往又赢得大众的支持。纵使人民没有投票权，或者投票也不会有实质的意义，但不代表人民不会支持独裁政府。所以在80年代末的时候，最令我惊讶的一件事情就是，在台湾呢，政府各方面的立场跟民意完全是脱节的，有很广大的嫌隙，广得令我惊讶。后来我仔细去思考，去玩味我认识的台湾朋友、外省朋友，他们思维上有什么差别，然后想办法用一套工具来去解决这个谜团。我发现台湾存在两个价值角力的族群，台湾存在一个跟民意脱节的政府，可是这个政府却又推崇像反攻大陆一样这么不可思议又难以执行的口号，到底为什么会如此呢？
So, as I said, I was looking for a tool for some kind of explanatory mechanism, maybe. And then I thought, hang on. Was I not aware of similar situations where governments had one set of values and loyalties and the population at large had entirely different ones? Where the government's loyalties were in fact focused on the interests of somewhere other than the place they governed? Well, of course, if you're British, you can hardly escape the realization that what you're looking at here is a classic case of colonialism. Do we need to define colonialism? There are probably some political scientists here who can talk exhaustively about different definitions, but I think we can surely agree that really it's a situation where a people or peoples are governed by a non-native regime, special emphasis on that non-native there, by the way, for the purposes of furthering the aims of a metropolitan center from which that regime comes. Now, it's probably important here just for me to point out that a non-native regime doesn't mean a regime composed entirely of non-natives. What it means is a regime imposed from outside, not something that has grown out of the polity, out of the people that are governed. For example, there were huge numbers of Indians involved in the administration of British India up until 47. But this did not make India any less of a colonial possession, since the function of its administration was to follow goals set in London. Similarly, it's worth pointing out that the nativization of the KMT's personnel starting in the 1960s, the inclusion of Taiwanese technocrats like Lee Dong Hui, for example, did not and does not make the KMT regime any the less alien.
就像我刚刚讲的一样，我试图找一个工具来解释台湾的这种窘境。那后来我就想到说，其实难道我会不知道说这个世界上也存在其他政府跟民意脱节的社会吗？难道我会不知道说在这种社会当中，政府或者是政府的支持者，他们的目标其实在辖区以外的地方吗？我当然知道啊，因为我身为英国人，我很难不意识到眼前台湾的这一切就是不折不扣的殖民主义。殖民主义还需要再定义吗？或许政治学家对此会争论不休、滔滔不绝吧。但我想大家都同意一件事情：所谓的殖民，就是统治者是外来政权，统治的目标跟殖民者的母国脱离不了关系。重点是，外来政权不代表统治阶级完全是外来者组成的。基本上，统治是外来者的意思就是说，这个政权本身的支持力量来自外部，而不是从本土滋养的。举例来说，像英属印度好了，在1947年印度独立之前，英属印度政府当中其实也笼络了不少印度人来统治印度，但是这不代表英属印度就不是外来政权，因为整个英属印度政府对英国伦敦中央是唯命是从的。同样的，国民党在1960年代也吸收了很多本土党员，其中不乏李登辉等人，但国民党本身外来政权的本质依然存在。
Now, some people will argue against the idea of KMT colonialism simply by pointing out that colonialism surely means one country governing another. And then they'll say that there is no country that governs Taiwan. I have to say, I think this is an extremely superficial understanding of what is involved, and I'm sure that you do too. A colonial state of affairs exists where the governing regime is non-native, i.e., it didn't grow out of domestic politics, and it acts to fulfill non-native goals. Now, in this situation, I don't honestly see how else the old pre-democracy KMT could be defined. So, what were, arguably still are, the major characteristics of KMT colonialism in Taiwan? Well, obviously it's China-centric political aims. But beyond those lay a nurtured identification with China. Actually, the KMT paid a lot of attention to the wider culture of the society outside of politics, And I'm tempted to say that it was probably the party's own background in Leninist communism, something the KMT doesn't really like to tell you about, of course, that probably led it to pay such attention. Rightist dictatorships are seldom so attentive to cultural transformation. But the KMT spent a huge amount of effort in enforcing a China-centric culture at the expense of any native variety. Now, this involved the importation and promotion of various aspects of Mandarin Chinese culture at the expense of local model ones. And this can range from, for example, the promotion of Beijing opera and the relative suppression of Taiwanese counterparts, to the long near exclusivity of Mandarin ballot on broadcast radio, limitations on non-Mandarin content on TV, and of course it also involved an education system which notoriously stressed all things Chinese, stressed in fact the idea of China as one's native land, with next to nothing being taught about Taiwan.
殖民为了国家，那台湾被哪一个国家统治了？为什么为了代表说他对现况根本缺乏深刻的见解，太肤浅了？我想各位应该也都同意这种说法。殖民的状态的存在来自殖民政府的外来本质，政府的根源并非本土的政治，也不是从本土发展的。而政府的各项政策作为的目的也不是在本土，都是要达到外来的目标。就这点来说，我想。 还有什么定义能够让国民党符合呢？那么国民党现在跟过去的殖民的特色到底有哪些呢？我想大概有两大特色吧，其中一个是该党以中国为核心的立场，还有对中国的认同。其实国民党还蛮关注社会文化的，不过这可能是因为国民党本身有列宁式的背景，那国民党当然不会告诉你说他曾经是一个列宁的政党，或者是曾经也倾向过共产阵营等等。 但是，一般来讲，右翼的独裁政权比较少被关心文化这种议题，但国民党却非常的用心，在台湾强加中国的文化来打压本土的文化。那强加的方式，不外乎就是推动国语教育，或者是引入外省文化来打压本土的文化，像是推广京剧来打压歌仔戏，就是一个很好的例子。另外一个例子就是广播节目上面几乎清一色都是国语的民谣。 那非国语的节目如果要搬上台面、搬上电视机的话，限制也蛮多的。再者，教育制度也全面的中国化，让学童相信中国是唯一的祖国，对台湾的种种几乎只字未提。Now,
this. Now, such an education system is in fact a kind of a classic colonial construct. It teaches what the colonial power thinks is important, and that is material which helps subjects understand, function within, and identify with the metropolitan culture, I mean the culture of the so-called mother country. One only has to think about Singaporean or South African or Australian school children learning the names of the kings and queens of England. The importance of Magna Carta, the rights and wrongs of the English Civil War, the delicacy of English lyric poetry, to see an analogy with Taiwan. Now, there was also, of course, a veil drawn over the circumstances of China's takeover of Taiwan in 1945, the illegitimacy of the ROC's claim to Taiwan, and the events of 1947. There was also the deliberate confusion of Taiwanese demands for civil rights with the mainland communist threat. This kind of confusion is also a familiar colonial strategy, very similar to that used by the British in Malaya in the 1950s, where aspirations for independence were deliberately confused with the threat from a small communist insurgency. A very similar thing happened in British-controlled Cyprus at the same time. However, somebody is going to say, wasn't all this long ago In 1990, the Wild Lily Movement forced reform of the National Assembly and the legislature. Taiwan has had five free and fair, so-called, presidential elections since then, and I think seven legislative elections. Meng Zhou is president not because of the force of white terror, but basically because more people voted for him than for Tsai Ing-wen. So, what relevance does the colonial past still have to modern Taiwan?
我刚刚讲的这种国民党的中国化的教育算是殖民的典型，也就是说，课纲完全是殖民者所认定的重点，使殖民者受殖民者能够理解、认同殖民母国的文化，甚至在殖民母国文化当中运作。各位不妨去想想看，新加坡、南非跟澳洲，在当年还在英国殖民的时候，这些学生要如何的背诵历代的英皇大宪章，还有英国的内战，还有英国的诗歌。再反过来看看台湾的教育，是不是就很清楚了呢？此外，在教育方面，中华民国接受台湾的合法性，还有二二八事件的内容，其实都被韩国盖过。而且，曾经台湾当局也故意以中共武力威胁为理由，拒绝赋予台湾公民权利。这种错乱也是殖民的一种经典。举例来说，像1950年代的英属马来亚，当时有人联党的威胁，那是个共产阵营。那这个时候，英国当局就拒绝让马来西亚独立，就因为有人联党。同时，英属塞浦路斯也有类似的情形。可是有些人会反驳说，英属马来亚跟塞浦路斯都是陈年往事的。可是大家再看看1990年的叶百合运动好了，确实也促使了国民大会的立法院的改革。此后，台湾有5次看似自由公平的总统大选，那还有7次的立法院大选。马英九当政不是因为白色恐怖，是因为他得了票比蔡英文。那么，殖民的过去，现在台湾到底有什么关联呢？
So, I think the major inheritances are these. Ethnic conflict, an ignorance of Taiwan and its history that have created a weak national identity, and a residual identification with China that weakens Taiwan's ability to resist Beijing's pressure. Now, there's an idea that is called divide and rule, and this was first stated by the father of Alexander the Great. So it's been around for about 2,500 years, and it's been a very loyal friend to imperial policies. It refers, of course, to a strategy where competition is deliberately introduced between groups to prevent them linking up and presenting a threat to an existing power structure. Now, the KMT has always been deft at exploiting fears among the non-Hokkien-speaking population in Taiwan that majority rule would mean the triumph of some kind of Hokkien chauvinism. It isn't accidental that areas with major concentrations of Hakka speakers usually vote blue, as do the Aborigines. And these unfortunate divisions amongst the people of Taiwan have not been helped in the past by attitudes among the Green camp, which have actually seemed to bear out this Hokkien chauvinism idea. As for an ignorance of Taiwan, this hardly needs more explanation, does it? We know why this is, but what matters is its effect on the formation of a national consciousness. Now, there are several contending theories about how a people become a nation. One thing about which they agree is the importance of a historical narrative that defines that people's uniqueness. Right? This narrative can be based in prehistoric myth, or it can actually be based on a reading of comparatively recent events. Part of France's historical narrative, for example, consists of the legends of Charlemagne. He's a king from the 8th century, so that's about, 1200, 1300 years ago? For Australia, on the other hand, a crucial part of its formative national narrative is a military campaign in Turkey in 1915. The State of Israel, and I say the State of Israel as separate from the Jewish people, looks to even more recent events for its sense of identity, events quite within living memory. some of the history and traditions that derive from some of the history and traditions that derive from it can sometimes actually even be invented. Scotland, for example, has cultivated a kind of nationalism that depends on a great deal of romantic historical invention, much of it at the beginning of the 19th century. But nevertheless, a history there must be, and that is something that generations of Taiwanese have, through the China-centric education system, been denied.
Now, 殖民的遗产又怎么样描述呢？很简单，其实就是撕裂族群，使台湾的大众对台湾本身历史了解很少，然后就无法形成国家的认同，甚至还有一部分的人对中国有保存认同的余温，而这个余温就削弱了台湾对抗北京的力道，所以基本上就算是一种各个击破渔翁得利的状态。而这种概念呢，起源于2500年前的亚历山大大帝的复兴，此后呢，分化策略就一直是帝国政策的好朋友。所谓的分化就是引入族群的撕裂纷争，防止各个族群团结凝聚，不然的话团结凝聚之后会影响，会威胁到统治者的统治地位。那国民党就非常善用，甚至非常善于利用非闽南族群的恐惧，使这些人认为说，如果多数政治成功的话，那就是扶老沙文主义的胜利。因此客家族群原住民普遍会偏蓝并非小得。但是另外一方面，绿营的态度很难改变这样的分化现象，因为目前绿营似乎还保有那么一点扶老沙文主义的色彩。至于大家对台湾的无知，大家也都知道原因嘛，不用再解释了。但重点是这种无知对于国家的意识有什么影响？一个民族怎么样形成国家，目前还是议论纷纷的，众说纷纭的。但是各方的共识大概是这样的，就是说一个国家要形成，一定要有个历史的描述。那这个描述呢，会伴随民族特色的产生。那这种描述的内容可以是史前的事，的传说，或者是近代的事件。像法国来讲，很多的历史描述来自8世纪的查理曼大帝。那澳洲就是近代的例子，澳洲的历史描述比较多来自一次大战的纽澳军团在土耳其的军事行动。那以色列国，在此呢，我说的并不是犹太人，是以色列国本身的历史描述比较多来自更近代的事件。这些事件可能活着的人都还有印象。那，但是当然，刚刚讲的是史实的历史描述，但是也可以是虚构的历史描述。像苏格兰国家认同的一个基础，就是19世纪所创造的很多浪漫的传说。但是，不论是渊源也好，近也好，是史实也好，捏造的也好，台湾总是要一份历史的描述吧。但这个描述却遭到了中国化的刻板所蒙蔽。
Now, as for a residual identification with China, I think I wrote in one of the essays in my book of the friend I had who would never accept Taiwan independence because it would mean to her at least some kind of loss, some diminution of Chinese culture. Now, of course, nothing prevents anyone in an independent Taiwan from reading Tang Dynasty poetry.But there is, to some people, a difference between seeing oneself as an inheritor of a Chinese literary tradition, or in some way exiled from it. It's like losing a birthright, we might call it. Now, perhaps more importantly, there's another element I wrote about, namely nationalism. And by that I mean the identification of oneself with more powerful entities,that you can use to sort of boost your sense of self-worth. Now, some here seek to identify with an ever more powerful China because, and we've all heard this before, Taiwan is so small. Probably few Taiwanese actually realize what a strange comment this is. I don't think I've ever heard anyone say, Singapore is so small.Or Ireland is so small. Scotland, for example, and of course I think about Scotland a lot these days because it very nearly became independent last September. Scotland has about the same level of wealth as Taiwan, and while it actually has twice the land area, it only has about 30% of the population. This has not stopped the powerful Scots nationalist movement seeking independence and only just failing to win it. Nobody says Scotland is so small. So when people say Taiwan is so small, I don't think they mean that Taiwan's a small island, which is arguably true. Actually, there are a lot of smaller islands in the world. But rather, that it is in some way not significant or powerful enough. And I find this strange. I mean, Taiwan has the same population as Australia. It has an economy bigger than half the countries in the European Union. Taiwanese belittle Taiwan unnecessarily. And I think this has much to do with the China-centric education they receive.
刚刚提及对中国认同的疑问，那这一点就让我想起了我在书中写的一篇文章，当中提到了我的一位台湾朋友，他不主张台湾独立，因为他认为这样做就等于是跟中华文化切割。可是没有人说台湾独立之后大家不准认同是啦。基本上对这种人来讲，大概就是这样的：把自己视为中华文化的继承者，跟置身于中华文化正统之外是两码子事。 如果置身在这个文化之外，就等于成了孤儿一样。那除此之外，我在书中也提到了民族主义。所谓的民族主义呢，就是去认同一个更强大的群体来提升自身价值的观感。那这样子说，就变成说，有一些人会去认同强大的中国，那他们的理由就是台湾太小了。而且很惊讶的事情就是，很少台湾人觉得这种话懂不通，因为从来没有人说过新加坡太小啊，或者爱尔兰太小。 就以苏格兰来讲好了，苏格兰的总财富跟台湾差不多，也苏格兰差异在去年九月独立了。面积是台湾的两倍，人口是台湾的三成。即使去年九月公投没过，独立公投没过，但没有人会说苏格兰太小不能独立啊。所以我想，当台湾人说台湾太小的时候，应该不是指面积吧？反正世界上其实还有更多更小的岛。但是我觉得他们的意思就是说台湾的力量不足。 但这也怪了，因为台湾的人口跟澳洲一样多，台湾的面积比起半数以上的欧盟国家都还要大，所以其实台湾根本不需要自我贬低啊。那这种自我贬低的心态，其实来自中国化的刻板。Now,
Taiwan's democratization is often regarded as an almost perfect case of the transition from dictatorship to democracy with as little chaos as possible. But I would argue that it has quite clearly had a very limited effect in removing the colonial legacy. Now, partly this has been because those who would decolonize have never had the power to put a radical agenda in place. The two Chen Shui-bian administrations were always severely limited by the lack of green control of the legislative yuan. But I would also argue... Anyway, where were we? Right, lack of green control of the legislative yuan, right? Okay, well, we all know that. But I'd also argue that the democratization was mired in a kind of short-sightedness, partly as a result of the Dang Wai movement's exposure to American ideas. I think this meant an adoption of third wave of democracy thinking that was very popular in the United States in the 1980s, and there was a regrettable lack of exposure to Marxist philosophy. What the Dang Wai really needed was the exposure to the work of an Italian Marxist by the name of Antonio Gramsci and his theory of cultural hegemony.
Yeah, this is actually the new stuff, by the way.
Now, Gramsci theorized that in a society, the ruling class manipulates the culture of that society, the beliefs, the perceptions, the values, the mores, in such a way that its worldview becomes the cultural norm. The ideology of the dominant class, which justifies the political and social status quo, is accepted in the society at large as natural, inevitable, beneficial. The prevailing norms within a society are not a product of natural, social, political and economic evolution, but in fact, a construct created by the ruling class to justify its ascendancy.
I mean, basically, it's a construct by the people on top to justify their being on top.
And everybody is led to believe that this is just the natural way things are. What we think of as the way things are is in fact more a case of the way someone would like us to see them.
葛兰西认为，社会中的统治阶层，他们很善于操弄文化，其中包含信仰啦、价值、道德观啦等等。那这样的话，可能这整个世界观就会被大众视为一种文化的常规。那支配阶层的意识形态就会合理化自己的统治，然后社会大众就会觉得说，哦，这种支配的关系是自然、不可避免且有益的结果。结果，这种强势的规范，其实本质上并不是自然发展的结果，可是大家却相信的这个是自然发展的结果，然后呢，统治地位就被合理化了。结果我们所认为的常态，反而是统治者所乐见的一种状态。
Now, this is a very, very rough explanation of Gramsci's idea, and I will be the first to agree that there are complexities and counterexamples that challenge it. For example, in my own country.There's a cultural hegemony which is actually quite at odds with the values of the government of the day. Then you might ask, well, how in Gramsci's theory does that happen? And we're not going to go into that now. In the case of Taiwan, however, I think we can immediately see the doctrines of the old colonial KMT, the idea of one China, the emphasis on Mandarin, the education system,as all part of exactly the kind of cultural hegemony that Gramsci refers to, an ideological construct that persuades people that the status quo is natural and that change is radical and destabilizing. Now, Gramsci's other important insight for Taiwan was this, that to change a system, you first have to fight on the level of cultural hegemony,before you descend to the political nuts and bolts. And what this means is that changing the way people vote, or even just giving them the vote, is not enough. We have to change the way they think. And this, I think, is the problem with Taiwan's democratization process, democratization experience, I should say. It concentrated too much on political process and not nearly enough on the cultural background.This also perhaps explains why the idea of the status quo, so often touted in Taiwan as the best possible option, is at the same time both fraudulent and actually kind of depressing. Anyway, the result, as we all know, the historical process here in Taiwan is that while the election process liberalized, the effect on society at large was actually quite minimal.Third wave democracy theorists applauded. Minimal disruption was exactly what they wanted. But the hegemonic values remained in place. In this sense, Taiwan was less lucky than its democratizing counterparts in Eastern Europe. Countries such as Poland, Hungary, East Germany, Czechoslovakia, where by 1989, the older ideology was so discredited that it disappeared almost overnight.One of Taiwan's problems actually has also been that the economic success attributed to the KMT since 1949 has actually helped entrench this hegemonic ideology.
我刚刚粗略地解释葛兰西的理论，不过我必须承认了，其实有很多复杂的论述都会反驳葛兰西的理论。
像我自己的国家当中的主流文化，法学的文化，刚好跟政府的价值完全相左，这个就是葛兰西文化解释的部分。但就台湾来讲，我们不难看出，在台湾的殖民教条大概包含一个中国，还有国语教育，还有课纲，这些全部都反映了葛兰西当中所讲的文化霸权。那结果呢，人民就相信说，哦，这个政治现况，台湾的政治现况是自然发展的结果，如果要颠覆这个现况，那根本就是乱来。从葛兰西的观点来看，台湾其实还有另外一个重点，那就是如果要改变台湾的体制，就必须要先对抗文化霸权，才能够进一步拆解国家机器。我的意思就是说，改变大家投票的方式，或者是赋予大家投票权，其实并不够，真正要改变的是选民的思维。这就是台湾民主化的弊病所在，缺陷所在。因为我们长期以来过于强调政治的程序，却没有想到政治程序背后的文化背景。这也能解释为什么台湾人还觉得说维持现状是最好的选择。其实这种选择根本就是愚弄人民，根本就令人沮丧。结果选举程序自由化了，可是社会却没有什么影响。第三波民主论者欢欣鼓舞，觉得说太棒了，我们没有流血，没有纷乱，达成了民主。结果强势文化还是存在。就这点看来，台湾可以说比东欧国家还要不幸，像是波兰、匈牙利、东德、捷克等。毕竟呢，这些东欧国家他们在1989年旧的体制、旧的思维在一夜之间被唾弃了，可是台湾却没有唾弃。结果呢，经济奇迹的果实全部归功给国民党。那1949年以来的蓬勃发展反而助长了国民党的统治。
Now, what Taiwan has long needed is a kind of root and branch reform that involves a rejection of key elements of the colonial regime and their replacement with native models. And of course, greenlining Taiwanese intellectuals have known this for a long time and have tried to effect change within the system when they could. I was rereading something I wrote at the end of 2004, in which it came at a period just after the head of the examination yuan was under fire for trying to introduce a local language element into civil service exams. And at the same time, the head of the education ministry was in trouble over changes to the history curriculum regarding the Cairo Declaration and the San Francisco Peace Treaty, and which of course had long been misrepresented by the colonial KMT. Now, at the time, I wrote this. To intellectuals, the idea of history as being mutable, written by the victors to embrace their own ideology and underwrite the legitimacy of a certain socio-political regime, might be commonplace. But there are an awful lot of ordinary people to whom history, such of it as they remember from school, is supposed to be fact. And it takes a long process of consciousness raising, a long process of social education for them to see things in a different light.
台湾真正需要的是根深蒂固的全面改革，必须要反对殖民者最关键的元素，然后用本土化的模型来取代。当然，这种事情偏绿的台湾知识分子早就知道了，也曾经把握过机会来改变体制。后来我回头去阅读我2004年写的文章，当时的背景是这样的：考试院在公职考试当中纳入闽南语的测验，结果遭到抨击。同时，教育部长他主张要改变历史课本当中《开国宣言》跟《旧金山合约》的内容，结果遭致了麻烦。当然，我们知道这个历史课本当中的内容本来是国民党扭曲的嘛。但是呢，我们知道遇到这么多麻烦，所以我就写了一封信给所有的知识分子。我说，或许大家普遍认为历史可以随便为胜利者修改啊、撰写啊，然后反映胜利者的意识形态，然后呢替主政者的合法性跟社会政治地位背书。但是对很多人而言，他们期待在学校念到的历史是史实，所以必须要花很多时间来提升意识、推广社会教育、调整民众的观念。
Now, basically, I think green intellectuals have had the right idea about what needs to be done, but have so far lacked the power to bring the right kind of change about. And one of the reasons for this is that they have tried political and bureaucratic means without having built the kind of mass movement in grassroots opinion that would really support a challenge to the colonial KMT's still existing cultural hegemony. Basically, they've challenged at the apex, the top of the pyramid, when they really needed to undermine the base. It was, for example, absolutely the right thing to change the name of the Chiang Kai-shek Memorial Hall in 2007. But when the KMT changed it back in 2009, there was hardly a murmur of dissent. There was no grassroots outcry. This was regarded as largely part of a political quarrel, not a serious question of identity. If you remember, KMT actually proposed a public consultation over restoring the old name. And then they said, oh, this won't take place because it's too divisive. Now there's a classic KMT tactic for you. Now, what's upsetting is not that the KMT would change the name back. I mean, for the young thieves to protect the legacy of the old thieves is only to be expected. What is depressing is that the public left them. Basically, a Taiwanese national consciousness remains weak, and this is in spite of political change and democratization, in spite even of 8 years of DPP presidency. So what is to be done?
基本上我觉得泛绿知识分子他们心有余力不足，没有办法带来实质的改变。不过这可能是因为他们只有尝试过政治或官僚的手段，没有想到说可以利用草根跟舆论的力量来撼动国民党的霸权文化价值。如果国民党的文化价值是一个金字塔的话，那绿营长期以来都是东挡金字塔的顶端。但如果你要拆掉金字塔，你要打地基。举例来说，2007年的时候，中正纪念堂改名为台湾民主纪念堂，我觉得此举完全正确，是很好的作为。但2009年国民党改回来的时候，没有人吭声，也都没有看到草根舆论的踏伐。结果表面上看起来只是蓝绿斗争，但是事实上这个攸关到国家意识的一个认同问题。我想当初国民党还提议说要把大众知识的匾额挂回去，然后还咨询大众的意见，结果呢又说哦这样会撕裂族群，不要做好了，然后不会良知，根本就是国民党的老套。不过这并不是令人难过的部分，令人难过的部分是社会大众居然默许国民党这么做。所以基本上尽管有了政治转型，有了民主化，还有8年的绿色执政，但台湾的国家意识还是相当的回落。
Now, about this, I probably have 3 things to say. The first is that when nationalist movements first emerged in the mid-19th century, they were usually built around a linguistic group with a traditional territory, which sought some kind of autonomy for itself. And I'm thinking here of Poland, Hungary, later on Finland, and as always, Ireland.Now, the rise of these nationalisms was always connected with cultural campaigns encouraging people within the group to identify less with the dominant ruling culture, which was usually that of one of the European empires of the day, and more with a unique history and culture of their own. Now, this involved a reworking of history into narratives that would sustain an idea of national uniqueness,an idea of pride, an idea of loyalty. It also involved a huge amount of linguistic work, often taking dialects that were regarded as extremely primitive and fashioning them into literary languages, right? Languages that could actually be used for very difficult and highly complicated modes of expression. Actually, we don't even have to look at Europe, for example, of linguistic nationalism. For example, the Baihua movement in 1920s China was a similar example. Singapore has actually managed to strengthen its identity by the promotion of Mandarin over the various Chinese dialects that its mixed population used to use. Taiwan, I think, probably needs to be the anti-Singapore, getting serious about the promotion and use of local languages. The idea of a local language component in major exams is surely one that needs to be pursued, if it isn't being pursued already. As I said, I haven't lived here for 7 years, so things might have changed. History is another area where public consciousness needs to be raised. One thing that those 19th century nationalist movements and post-colonial regimes, that's modern post-colonial regimes, have in common is the development of a historical narrative emphasizing uniqueness often born out of struggle. There is no reason to think that this cannot be done in Taiwan.
对此，我想发表三个意见。第一个是十九世纪中叶，当民族主义初次掀起的时候，主要围绕在语言跟固有领土的议题方面。那其中呢，他们这场运动的目的是要达到某种程度的自治。那这个时候我就想到了波兰、匈牙利以及后来的芬兰还有爱尔兰。那这些国族主义发起之后，往往也伴随文化的运动，鼓励族群当中的成员减少对统治文化的认同，对欧洲主要帝国的认同，增加对自身民族的认同，来达到国家的独特性、民族自豪跟爱国的精神。那除了文化认同之外，还有运动之外，当然这也伴随了语言的运动。原本民族他们自己的语言或方言是被视为野蛮的语言，但后来他们把这种语言升级为文学的语言，可以拿来建构比较复杂、比较有诗情画意的那种语言。那其实也不需要舍近求远找欧洲的例子，其实1920年代中国的白话文运动也是一个很好的例子，新加坡也是。近几年，新加坡政府推广普通话，来取代新加坡华族使用的闽南语跟粤语。但是我觉得台湾应该走新加坡的反向，提升本土语言的意识，把本土语言纳入公职考试，反而应该是当务之急。提升大众意识，自然也离不开历史，像十九世纪民族主义运动啊，以及后殖民政权的共同点，就是经历一番斗争之后，发展新的意识模式，强化的独特性。而我觉得没有理由说台湾做不到。
The fact is, Taiwan isn't just another province of China, a small place where not much happened. Right? Its settlement and its history are utterly unlike those of any other areas of China. Its attachment to China during the Qing Dynasty was peripheral. It was famous for its civil unrest. They said a minor rebellion every 3 years, a major one every 5. It was a lawless frontier society, full of conflict. We're all familiar with the way that the American Wild West has been mythologized, and how essential that is to the American, the strength of the American's identity, the American's idea of what being an American is about. Why can't the same be done for the Wild East? Then, if you think about it, there are the Japanese years and the struggle for Taiwanese to get civil rights during this period, right? The struggles of Lin Xianteng, for example, the assimilation society, the long and hopeless struggle to create a Formosan parliament during the Japanese years, and perhaps the most important movement of all, the Taiwan Cultural Association, as you all know, founded in 1921 by the Dr. Chen Wei-shui, which has been described as the single most important organization responsible for the development of Taiwanese nationalism. Now, the Cultural Association is kind of almost forgotten, actually, let's face it. So let's just talk about what they did. Its aims were the awakening of Formosan national consciousness and the development of a political atmosphere favorable to the principle of self-determination. And its methods involved organizing summer schools, evening lectures on a vast number of topics, including Chinese history and culture, Taiwanese history, law, sanitation, hygiene, public health, journalism, sociology, marriage problems, and a lot more. They actually used the lecture form, this idea of holding lectures in the evening, and they thought of this as being essential to basically overcome both widespread illiteracy at the time, I mean we're talking about the 1920s, 1930s, and of course very strict Japanese control on what you could publish. The association also sponsored Taiwanese opera performances. It also played a cat and mouse game with the Japanese police, pushing boundaries in a society of strict censorship. It should, amongst Taiwanese, have something like the iconic status of the anti-slavery movement in England, or a colonial liberation movement in a former colony, perhaps the Viet Minh in Vietnam. But few Taiwanese ever seem to have heard of it. Taiwan's deeply ambivalent situation in World War II, retrocession, 228, the White Terror, the economic miracle, the struggle for democracy, you know, Taiwan actually has a vivid and quite moving history, and yet few Taiwanese know what it is.
毕竟台湾并 台湾跟中国各个省份不一样，台湾的移民历史其实跟中国各地大不相同。像清理时期的台湾，不过就是个边陲，有非常多的社会动荡。俗话说三年一小反，五年一大反，就是台湾当时的写照。所以台湾当时可以说是一种没有，就是无政府状态的一种边疆地带。大众应该这样讲吧，就是说，你看台湾当时的状况，这么多社会动荡，跟早期美国西部刚开发的时候是不是一样的？那我们也知道，美国西部的传说也是美国身份认同的一个重要的环节。那既然美国可以拿西部来当作自我认同，那台湾当初的社会动荡不也可以当作我们认同的元素呢？那除了清理时期之外，还有日治时期。日治时期，台湾人也非常的极力争取公民权，像是林献堂在皇民化运动时期，就率领一票人到日本去争取台湾议会的设置。此外呢，蒋渭水他在1921年创立的台湾文化协会，可以说是非常重要的运动。不过大家可能都不太了解蒋渭水当时做了什么吧，我们课本可能不见得写这么多。那基本上台湾文化协会主要是要在 主要做的是提升升台湾的民族意识，并且塑造一个比较适合进行民族自决的一个政治氛围。那使用的方法举凡成立夏令营啦，或者是办傍晚的演讲活动，当中的主题也广博非常多，像是中国的历史、台湾的历史、法律啦、婚姻制度啦、社会问题等等，还有公共卫生议题等等。那这样子的演讲活动跟夏令营也大幅增长了台湾在20、30年代的识字率，还有台湾总督府对出版限限制也因此大幅降低了。而且台湾文化协会也资助了台湾歌仔戏的演出。但是在这个过程当中，文化协会也必须要跟日本警察来做立场，必须要挑战日本当初威权体制的极限。其实从这点看来，其实台湾人在当时充分具备了英国反奴还有越南反抗法国独立的那种精神跟元素。那在反观台湾在二次大战的矛盾的地位啦、二二八事件啦、经济奇迹、白色恐怖等等的元素，其实我们都知道台湾有着非常多元且精彩的历史，
是我们自己都不这么了解。Now, in a way, I kind of think what we need is something like the zeal, the hard work, the determination of the cultural association matched with contemporary technology. Now, back in the UK, for example, the BBC has a channel of which the major part of its content is popular history. It takes something that people might have heard of, but know few details about. It reduces it to easily digestible, interesting chunks, and it leaves audiences much better informed about the Industrial Revolution, or the development of British sea power, or the development of the freeway system. All this sounds quite dry, but actually it's quite interesting stuff.Nothing prevents the same happening here in Taiwan, except that few seem interested in doing it. Another way of popularizing history in the UK has been through historical drama, both in books, on TV, and in movies. The books and TV series of Hilary Mantel's Wolf Hall, a work about the 16th century politician and courtier Thomas Cromwell, have created a huge interest in that period of history.The same could be done in Taiwan with suitable subjects and interesting plots. In Scotland, the film Braveheart, starring Mel Gibson, who interestingly enough, of course, isn't Scottish, as you know, has done more to encourage Scottish independence than 30 years of political campaigning, despite its startling, actually almost laughable historical inaccuracies.
What we're really talking about here are
stories. The word the academics actually love is narratives. Stories in history, stories about history. It's these stories that people weave together to create a national story for themselves. And that's what national identity is. It's seeing yourself as part of that story. And it's these stories, I think Taiwanese have barely begun to put together this national story. And yet, these stories are needed to counter the stories, the narratives of the colonial era. The KMT had a story, the one about Taiwan being snatched from the motherland and then returned, and how the party's benevolent rule brought prosperity, and how tired we are of hearing this. But where's the alternative? We need stories that stress Taiwan's uniqueness as opposed to stories that stress China's importance. Put in the most basic terms, how often have you seen TV dramas set during some dramatic event in China? When I was in Taiwan, World War II always seemed to be a favorite. How often have you seen similar historical dramas, right, with a historical setting, but set in Taiwan?
我们需要的是当初台湾文化协会的那股热血，然后搭配现在的科技。像是英国来讲，英国广播公司 BBC 就有一个频道专门在报道大众历史。那当初提及的是可能大家有一点熟悉，可是不完全了解的东西，那就言简意赅，然后用比较简化的方式做成老少咸宜的节目，一方面娱乐大众，一方面提升大家的认识。像是大家因此工业革命啊，英国海军发展啊，还有英国公民建设等等。那其实台湾有这条件怎么做，可是却没什么人对此感兴趣。那另外一个很有趣的一点就是，其实英国也有历史剧。那这个历史剧呢，可以是书籍、电视节目或者是电影。像英国有一个很有名的历史剧，叫做希拉瑞·麦特尔写的那个《狼厅》（Wolf Hall）。那当初讲的是16世纪的政治家汤马士·克劳默的故事。那因为这个历史剧的关系，所以台湾所以英国很多人因此对亨利八世那个年代的英国感到非常的兴趣。其实台湾大可以效仿英国的做法，把适合的历史情节编写成电视剧给大家看。那苏格兰，我想大家应该也都蛮不陌生的一点，就是说，大家记得那个吉伯逊他主演的《英雄本色》吗？那这个电影当中其实有非常多可笑的历史人物，但即使如此，这一部脍炙热口的电影掀起的苏独浪潮反而胜过了苏格兰那一部30年的政治运动，这么厉害。所以这边的重点其实就是故事，刚讲的都是故事嘛。那学者一般称故事为描述，但无论名称是什么，其实故事就是故往之事，就是历史。历史可以把人编织在一起，创造共同的过去跟身份。但这件事情可惜的是，台湾连做都还没开始做。但是唯有一套故事才能够让台湾对抗殖民的另外一套故事。国民党给大家的故事是什么呢？就是台湾被日本侵占了，后来光复了，回到祖国的怀抱，回到中华民国的德政，听都听腻了吧。但是要怎么样取而代之呢？我们需要一套新的故事来强调台湾的独特性，来对抗另外一个故事，因为另外一个故事强调的是中国的重要性。简言之，我们以前像我之前在台湾看到了很多电视剧，都是在讲说巴黎抗战啊，或是中国历代各个朝代，像是什么雍正帝国这种的。可是我都没看到台湾各个历史故事的电视影集，所以大家想想看，是不是这样的一回事呢？
Now you're probably actually a bit disappointed here because you're kind of thinking this is it, this is its main point, make better TV programs.Is that really the answer to the colonial legacy in Taiwan? But actually, of course, my point isn't, it's not quite so superficial. What I'm trying to say is that we need to create a counter-narrative to the colonial KMTs. Right? We need to create our story, a Taiwanese story. The KMT has a story, it's a China story. Where's the Taiwanese story? How many Taiwanese know it?Out of this, you hope, can come a new nationalism, not a Chinese nationalism, a Taiwanese nationalism. I remember Li Donghui many years ago talking about the idea of a community of destiny, and I thought this was a hugely valuable insight. President Li's point was that everyone in Taiwan came originally from somewhere else. They came here usually to escape problems from somewhere else. Famine, war, poverty. Taiwan in this sense is like a lifeboat, and everyone has to work together to keep it afloat. It's a lifeboat that has been rocked by huge storms with rebellion, invasion, then dictatorship, followed by then war, and then more rebellion, and then more dictatorship. But this history of adversity should create a bond. That is the final legacy of KMT colonialism, that its divide and rule use of ethnicity has, until recently, resulted in these bonds being very weak, perhaps even barely formed. And strengthening them is now, I think, the primary task that needs to be done. Thank you very much.
我想刚刚讲的这么多，大家可能有点失望，感觉好像简直去殖民化要做的唯一的事情就是拍拍电影而已，没有那么肤浅的。因为我这边强调的是故事，我们必须要重新塑造一个台湾的故事，来对抗中国的故事，来对抗殖民的故事，然后从这个新的台湾的故事当中，可以产生一个新的台湾的民族主义。我记得当年李登辉提出了地域共荣概念，我觉得蛮好的。他的意思是说，台湾岛上的每一个人的祖先都来自他方。当初未来是因为要躲避他方的问题，诸如饥荒、战乱或者是贫穷等，所以台湾某种形式上算是一个救生艇，大家必须同舟共济。但是这个救生艇都遇到暴风、遇到大浪，像是内忧而外患等等，一波未平，一波又起。这么坎坷的过去，理论上能够在台湾形成一个连结才对。但是国民党的分化统治目的就是要削弱这个连结，使之无法再生。现在的当务之急就是要强化这道连结。谢谢大家。
非常感谢艾伦先生非常具有国际观然后历史纵深的这个演讲。最后讲到这个叙述这个部分，想到我这里看过最多次的一个电视影集是一部叫做《寒流》，应该不太有看过。然后看过最多次的电影是《梅花》跟《八百壮士》。我觉得这叙述这个问题，应该大家知道是故事嘛。然后它所牵涉到的是一种观点、记忆以及一些感受。所以最后这边非常非常重要，是我们要自己来说我们的故事，我们要重新来改写。那些被国民党放在大脑里面非常非常久的一些历史的一些记忆。那艾伦先生刚刚讲，我想大家很多人今天都是心里面抱着一个疑问，就是说到底要怎么样去除国民党的这个殖民的这个体制。那艾伦先生刚刚演讲里面，我个人来讲觉得讲到一个重点，就是说光是只有社会运动，光是只有改变投票行为事实上是不够的。光每天在嘲笑说那个9%可能更低，在嘲笑这个党每天在那里秀下限本来不够。因为艾伦先生从不管是葛兰姆西，或者是大家也可以再想一想阿图瑟的那个意识形态国家，你们发现到说殖民统治它事实上是已经根深蒂固到我们日常生活当中非常非常细微的一些东西。包括说小孩子要上写作班，可能就送到那个国语日报社，还知道那个是党产。我后来也跟我家小朋友讲说过，可能就不让你去。那所以你会发现，就跟生活习惯、跟我们的想象、跟我们的语言都有非常非常密切的一些关系。那另外一个重点就是，过去台湾这几十年来，我们常常引以为傲的所谓的民主改革，事实上是不够。我们认真的来想，可能只有转型，没有正义。那该怎么走，该怎么做，其实都还蛮多的一些可能性。所以，我们接下来就请我们的国成老师来回忆一下刚刚艾伦先生的这个演讲，那也许会有提供一些不同的一些思考点。好，欢迎国成老师。
谢谢主持人。这个我还是要再次强调，就是说，啊，我以前读到这个艾伦先生的这个论述啊，好，开始体会到，就是说台湾真正的问题啊。甚至不是国民党不倒台湾不会好，而是殖民不倒台湾不会好。因为呢，在2012年的讲演，那个大报就说，就 这个国民党的国号，其实是殖民的国号，把一些变成台湾人民的一部分之一。所以呢，在上星期六的讲演里面哦，有人说要怎么样把这样的体制一拳打扁？我说这个问题不是一拳打扁，因为他会一拳打扁到自己。啊，重点呢是像那种得到白血病的患者，逐步把你自己的就是骨髓把它换掉。那么我当时体会到这个概念的时候，所以我在2004年哦，我就本来我在惠斯康辛大学读博士，我后来觉得我希望能够到一个当过殖民地的地方去看一下台湾能够学到什么，所以我就从惠斯康辛大学转到雪梨的新南威尔斯大学，在那边看到呢，澳洲人做了些什么事情，澳洲人做的事情呢，就是逐步的从他们的英雄故事，第一次世界大战，第二次世界大战，去建立他们自己的国家认同。在那之前呢，澳洲人认为说我们就是女皇陛下的子民，我们是英国人，可是后来呢，在二次大战之后呢，他们开始逐渐出现了 Australian， 我们是澳大利亚人的身份。那么我不断的呢就在想说，这样的事情有没有办法在台湾发生呢？可是呢，我发现在台湾基本上大家所在做的事情，在社会运动也好，政治运动也好，各项努力哦，我觉得几乎90%的力量哦，都还是放在改革中华民国的政治。这个要说三遍哈，是在改革中华民国的政治，是在改革中华民国的政治，而不是在认清这一个外来政权带来的这个殖民对台湾的影响。甚至有人呢，一听到外来政权或殖民就立刻污名化。实际上或者认为说对于这个台湾现在有自主的选举这件事情好像视若无睹。其实呢在亚洲很多地方呢很多地方呢这个被殖民，例如香港他们现在怀念的是殖民者而不是现在他实际上是出生在香港的这个本土政权。我们知道英国在香港统治有28任总督，这28个人没有一个人在香港出生，也没有一个人是不是英国人香港回归之后呢，现在第三任的特首都是在香港土生土长的但是非常有趣的是说，这三个人即使没有经过民意的产生，他们跟他们全家人都没有外国大。但是呢，在另外一个自认为已经民主的地方呢，人们呢可以毫无疑惑的完全接受他们的领导人全家人都不在这块土地上生活，甚至呢，不要说不自认为是台湾人，连自认为中华民国人都不愿意。这让我觉得非常奇怪哈。虽然作为一个台湾人应该不奇怪，可是后来我到国外去之后，我还是觉得非常奇怪。那么，艾顿先生的总结就是说，除了政治之外他强调故事的重要。但是呢，我们可以看到台湾的这些戏剧也好，媒体也好。到底有没有台湾的故事到底有没有台湾的历史例如说呢，我们看到说这个一部连续剧居然用就说被认为是描写台湾在清朝时候历史的，好像龙飞凤那在讲什么我认为它既不符合历史也不符合文化，但是呢这一块在台湾是最没有人注意最没有人注意，所以基本上我在以前在学校或者是在其他地方我以前在青辅会，行政院青辅会服务的时候，我当时跟郑丽君主委，也就是这个地方的创办人讲，就是说，我们青辅会呢，基本上送给同学们或者是任何地方的礼物就是打破神话生活。常常大家体会到，就是说，即使当时被认为是政党轮替了即使当时呢被认为是本土执政的但是呢，神话还没有打破，殖民还没有解除，所以用了那本书所以那个。我的意思就是说，但是呢，台湾的教育或者是台湾的社会运动在不在乎讲故事这件事情，在不在乎讲故事这件事情，我不鼓励讲故事这件事情呢，这又碰到另外一个主要的问题，就是说，大家认为讲故事只能讲好的，只能讲好的，只能讲说这些过去的谁对台湾有贡献谁对台湾有这个做了一些好的事情。其实上呢，我们要的故事应该是好的、坏的、成功的、失败的值得纪念的或令人沮丧的，我认为这些故事都要 可是呢，我发现哦，包括我的很多朋友在内，包括所谓的台派在内哦，很多人是不愿意面对事实，很多人是不愿意面对现实，很多人是认为说很多不好的事情、坏的事情，我们不去面对，我们予以否定，它就会自动的不存在。好，我认为呢，这一点就是对于我们要写台湾的故事、理解台湾的历史一个非常巨大的障碍。好，那么这是我在读了这个艾顿先生的著作哈，而且跟他聊过很多次之后呢，好，我认为说呢，啊，他的看法的确是台湾的需要。另外呢，艾顿先生刚才提到一个名词哈，叫做 divide and rule。啊，这个字呢，其实简单的讲哈，就是我们常讲的五龙治水啦，啊，就是说这个殖民者呢，像刚才讲到说，他就会操纵一个族群的文化，好让大家彼此不能团结，然后呢，让一个族群对付另外一个族群，然后呢，在这些族群里面争取啊，这个对他们认同的人啊，去进行他们的统治，这个严格讲就是五龙治水。好，但是呢，这个观念呢，在台湾，我觉得说呢，也遭到相当多的质疑。我认为说，这应该不是说对于我或者是我的兄弟叔伯之间的反对，而在于什么呢？在于不愿意面对事实的这个传统的惯性。我认为说，对台湾来讲，我们今天要让台湾变成一个更好的土地，好，要建立真正的国家，我认为这些问题都一定要面对，而且要消除。谢谢。
是非常简短、精彩、有力的这个补充，所以这个也是牵涉到这个文化自信的这个问题。每个人他扪心自问，我们是不是对那些所谓的大国强国文化有那种根深蒂固的那种文化倾陷？那反映出来，事实上也是一种文化自卑的一种情节。那我们接下来就要开始进行我们的 Q&A 的这个是现场观众提问的这个习惯。那我们就用这种方式进，就是我们每一轮就接受三个问题，好，大家在发问的时候请尽量简短，把它浓缩在一分钟之内。那就比较公平起见，请先放下来一下。好，请这边一位，然后这边这一位，那这里这位，就这是三位。第一轮，
哎，你好，那个基于那个台那个旧金山合约的那个台湾主权未定论啊，我们如果大家讲那个台湾独立啊，你所认为台湾独立，就台湾是从中国独立，或者是台湾从中华民国独立，或者台湾从世界独立，哪一个比较接近于准确的台湾独立的定义？那另外一个就是说台湾如果放弃使用中文跟注音符号，这对台湾脱离中国文化霸权是不是一个有效的方法？谢谢。
I'm just curious, as a third party, what do you think about United States, the Taiwan Relations Act? I don't know, do you think it will be the handicap for the Taiwan independent movement? That's my question, what I'm thinking.
第三位是。
Greeting, Mr. Aiton. I wanted that.We talk about the, today we hear we talk about is a moral issue or a political, political issue. This bad dream, ridiculous drama being played for four centuries. The colonialism in Taiwan. What is the character of indigenous people of Taiwan in this drama. I'm very security of your perspective, your opinions, sorry. If you do not recognize all the rights of the indigenous people of Taiwan, it means you deny indigenous people are not human beings. It is my humble opinions. Thank you.
这个是问到说我们在追求独立的时候，如何来看待原住民的一些基本的一些人权的一些问题？希望艾顿先生做一些回应。我这样建议，如果大家用英文
发文的话，请自行翻译一下，节省时间。好，那我们就请台中先生。
其实用中文问，我可以重复翻到英文。大家可以
啊，请各位就尽量用中文没关系了，因为张先生可以同步翻译给太多信息，这样让其他的人也可以听得懂，没问题。
The first question about the San Francisco Peace Treaty and Taiwan's status. I think.As far as we, well, I mean, one thing we know about the San Francisco Peace Treaty is that Japan gave up Taiwan, nobody else was given Taiwan. The ROC was supposed to be a caretaker government here on Taiwan. I think if you were to put the San Francisco Peace Treaty together with the United Nations Charter, the obvious legal aspect of that is that basically at some time after the peace treaty was signed, Taiwanese should have had a vote, a plebiscite, a referendum on whether they wanted to be independent or whether they wanted to be reattached to China. Obviously, of course,This never happened, and never has happened to this day. The Taiwan Relations Act, I'm not sure. You think that this is likely to be a problem for Taiwan independence? I don't know. I mean, the biggest problem for Taiwan independence is the fact that the Chinese threaten to invade, attack, and bring war to Taiwan should Taiwan ever actually declare independence. So the Taiwan Relations Act basically it mandates that the Americans should support Taiwan with military equipment. It doesn't mandate that if Taiwan's attacked that they should come to its rescue. The Americans, of course, haveAlways been a bit scared of the Taiwan Relations Act because it's highly ambiguous as to what they actually are committed to do. And if they stand on the wording of the Relations Act, then they look weak. If they go with the obvious sort of moral idea embodied in the Relations Act, then actually they look like they're going to go to war with China. But whether that's actually a problem for Taiwan's independence, I think it is actually almost a peripheral issue. And finally, about Aboriginals, I don't think anyone's denying the Aboriginals that their rights, are they? Obviously, they are people on Taiwan. The point is, everybody on Taiwan should have the same set of rights. Under the colonial KMT, that wasn't actually true. Some people had more rights than others.I've always thought that as I said before, there used to be a very strong ethnicity about relations between ethnic groups in Taiwan tended to actually dominate politics.Certainly, and much to the weakening of the Green cause, I should say. Basically, because a lot of non-Hokkien people thought that Taiwanese nationalism was really an excuse for the Hokkien people to kick everybody else around.What actually, of course, you need is a non-ethnically based nationalism, and the nationalism should be based on, I think, two things, right? The first, that everybody who's born in Taiwan is Taiwanese, and second, that it doesn't matter if you're in the green camp, the blue camp, or whatever camp you are, nobody, you, nobody should kick the Taiwanese about. The essence, I think, of Taiwanese nationalism doesn't necessarily have to be Taiwanese independence as long as there are an awful lot of people here in Taiwan who don't want that independence. Now, you might say that's regrettable, or, most of the people here probably think that that is regrettable. Nevertheless, it's a fact. And a successful nationalism really has to kind of find a way to incorporate those people. And I've always thought the way that they should be incorporated is to say the essence of Taiwan nationalism isn't necessarily independence, it's self-determination. It's that nobody can force Taiwan to make a change unless they actually ask the people of Taiwan about that change first. Now, of course, in that sense, it doesn't matter what ethnicity you are, you have a choice. And it would be up to you how you exercise that choice. And obviously, there's room for everybody in Taiwan, Aboriginals, the Hakka, the Hokkien, the Mainlanders. The idea that nobody should force you to do something without your consent, that isn't ethnically based. It's civic. It's a question of civic freedom, and I think it's something that everyone can actually understand and get on board with.
第一个问题是《旧金山合约》的主权未定论。我们知道，在《旧金山合约》当中，日本放弃了对台澎的主权，但是这个主权并没有给予任何一个国家。那中华民国只是一个代管的政治实体。那如果这个和平的协定要跟联合国西方结合的话，那就变成说台湾应该要举办一个公投，由台湾全体人民来决定要不要独立，还是要归化为中华民国。但显然这件事情没有发生。那至于台湾关系法来讲，有些人认为说这个法律是台独的阻力，但我觉得台独最大的阻力其实是中国对台湾的武力威胁。中国说如果台湾独立的话，就不放弃武力犯台。那基本上台湾关系法本身当中也规定说美国要支持台湾的军事，要对台军售，但是没有说一定要帮助台湾，只是说在台海战争当中一定要帮台湾。可能一方面美国也怕台湾关系法，所以故意把这个内容写得很模糊。如果退一步的话，可能台湾关系法会写得太弱，觉得好像没有帮到台湾。但是如果把太多的意识形态放进这个法律内容的话，就感觉好像在跟中国开战一样。所以基本上，这个是一个很大的就是模糊空间的问题。那以原住民的人权问题来讲，我相信应该没有任何人主张要剥夺原住民的权利。理论上，在台湾岛上面的所有人应该是每个人平权的，但是在国民党的殖民时代，并不是每个人权利都平等，有些人有特权嘛。所以我一直觉得，从以前呢、我们看观察台湾政治的时候，其实族群关系一直都主宰着政治的演变，像是说，可能闽南的商人主义导致许多绿营的一些政治目标遭到弱化，尤其是被非闽南族群所弱化。但是我觉得其实应该要这样子统整全台湾的民族，可是呢，很多非闽南族群像是什么客家人啊或原住民啊，他们会觉得说如果把台湾的族群全部凝聚在一起的话，就变成闽南沙文主义的胜利了。那我觉得其实如果要在台湾发展一个全新的国族主义的话，就必须打破台湾族群的分化，不要去分你是闽南人我是客家人等等，我们要重新定义说只要出生在台湾这个土地上的人全部都是台湾人，不分党派，不可以互动。那其实这个主张的精髓在于台湾的全新的国族主义并不等于台独，因为有些人他们反对台独就是会怕有这样子的民族主义的产生，他们可能觉得说民族主义产生之后就等于主张台独，他们觉得很怕。虽然说我刚刚讲的说民族主义不等于台独是真的，但是很可惜的是没有什么人知道。那我觉得其实最好的方法其实就是还是想办法凝聚一下各个族群，那可能要先让大家 获得一下教育，知道说其实，民族主义、国族主义的诞生并不等于台独，反而等于台湾的民族自觉。民族自觉的意思就是说，外国的任何力量都不能逼迫台湾人做任何决定，而且这并不是民族方面的一个观念，而是台湾既有的公民权利的观念。因此呢，我相信呢，公民自由本身大家都觉得说是一个蛮容易懂的概念，那我们不妨从公民自由的角度来出发，来倡导一下，其实我们各个族群是可以团结一致的。
在稍等之前，艾顿先生的那个演讲里有提到说，殖民体制他会去操纵这个族群的这些矛盾冲突。那我觉得这个也是我们要去重新把它找出来的一个故事，就是说我们要去追问说，国民党是用什么方式在挑动、在操纵台湾的族群的这种矛盾冲突。有一个例子就是像大家不是注意到那个考选部那个考那个公务人员特考。曾经在某一个时代里面，事实上他是哪一个省级的人，有多少的保障名额，你会发现到那个事实上就是一个很重要的一个很重要的一个历史的一个珍贵的一个记录了。那另外像民族主义这个部分，我觉得大家也需要放在心里面，就是说我们也要不要把它污名化，对，应该要把民族主义把它去污名化，就是说我们理解民族主义的方式，不只是也不应该是从所谓的血缘的这个角度来理解，它也可以是一种公民民族主义，也可以是一种文化的一个民族主义。这个就是一个简单的推。那很怕忽略掉后面的这边的朋友，所以我们底下来这一轮的这个前面两个问题，我们是不是就让这边的朋友们提问一下？那如果大家想要请问一下国成老师，想多听他说一些的话，也可以把问题给国成老师。好，现在前两个问题就开放这边的朋友。
My question is, to my understanding, KMT was brought to Taiwan by the United States and was picked up by the United States. But now KMT seems like it came out of line. And what do you think the role?Of United States in Taiwan decolonization. My point is that the government is not the same. The government is not the same. The government is not the same. The government is not the same.
Thank you.我住在外的，我本人的母语是台湾国语的。我的其他的问题是讲，其实咱国民党是民统伊长期以来，咱台湾的教育体制，不管是国文，其实就是中文，啊，甲数学、物理、化学，拢总拢是用北京话来讲。所以讲，我伫只咧问讲，咱咧安怎来有效来推行咱的母语教育？啊，第二个问题是。咱的母语教育，其实咱台湾话唔仅是台湾华语话嘛，嘛有咱台湾客家话，嘛有咱台湾各种的原住民话。啊，如何来照顾着咱各种台湾人的语言，伫咱的台湾人的教育体系内底？多谢。
One culture, and if Taiwan is going to independent, should we? I'm wondering if this is necessary for us to use a lot of languages like Cantonese, Hakka way, and Taiwanese as our national language or open memory. Thank you.
Let me just go back to, actually this language question is quite an interesting one. But first let's deal with the Americans. The Americans didn't actually send the KMT to govern Taiwan. I mean, what there was a there was a rough agreement between the wartime allies about what should happen to former Japanese territories, former Japanese colonies, once Japan was defeated. If you were to, and if Japan's defeated and basically the Japanese government here in Taiwan has no status, somebody's got to come in and take over. And that somebody was chosen to be the ROC simply because they were the nearest military force, the biggest military force, and actually, of course, Chiang Kai-shek put pressure on the Allies to be able to do that. But I think if you were to say that, I think it's grossly inaccurate to say that the ROC on Taiwan is the result of an American gift, if you want. Basically, when these things were decided, which were, I mean, the Cairo Conference was in, what, 1942, I think, and then, of course, there was Potsdam in 45, but, of course, at the time that Potsdam happened, the war in the Far East was still going on. The atom bombs hadn't been dropped. So most of the thought that was given to what was going to happen in the Far East, nobody knew about the atom bombs, remember, except the Americans themselves. The discussion about what was going to happen in the Far East was all very vague because nobody knew when the war would end. They didn't actually know that it was going to end within a couple of months. So as I say, it was vague, it was loose, the ROC was sent here, the Chinese army was basically sent here because who else was going to sort things out? The Americans didn't have the manpower, the Japanese couldn't do it, they were defeated. You can't let a defeated government stay in place because there's nobody to replace them. That's how things happened. And the ROC came here as temporary managers and never left. About the linguistic question, how do you, in a society where everybody learns Mandarin, everybody speaks Mandarin, the vast majority of people, of course, speak Mandarin, where Mandarin is totally dominant, how do you create linguistic diversity, or more linguistic diversity? And to be honest, I think in the school system, isn't that where you create it? I see no reason why school students at various levels, perhaps even up to the university BNCAL exam, shouldn't have to pass exams in a native language. It can be a Taiwanese Aboriginal language, it can be Hokkien, it can be Hakka, right? I really don't see why that can't happen, and I actually think it would be relatively easy to arrange. I should point out that having more than one official language is problematic. I don't think it is at all. Switzerland has four official languages, and I don't think anybody thinks that Swiss national identity is diminished by having so, or confused by having so many languages. In fact, actually, Swiss national identity is one of the toughest identities in Europe. The Swiss know they're Swiss, and there's no mistake about it. India, for example, has, I think, 19 official languages. I don't think that has in any way weakened India as a state. You know, it has one big language up in the north and lots of smaller languages in the south and the east. And most of the bureaucrats, of course, speak English. That's the kind of common language. And I don't think there's a linguistic problem in India at all. As I said, there's no reason why Taiwan shouldn't have more than one official language. There's no reason why languages other than Mandarin shouldn't be taught in schools, promoted in schools, and examined in schools. And I think actually it would be a jolly good thing if they were.
First, 是盟军在瓜分日本的前殖民地所造成的，那是一个粗浅的共识。那基本上，中华民国会来主要几个原因是，中华民国最近有地人关系，那可能蒋介石对于盟军有些施压，说他们想要台湾。那除此之外呢，大家也都知道，1942年开罗会议，还有波茨坦宣言是1945年，但这两个会议在开始在讨论的时候呢，日本都还没投降，原子弹都还没有丢下去。 所以大家不知道远东的战事什么时候会停止，所以在远东的事务讨论方面做得非常模糊，就很草率的把中华民国送到台湾来了。那中华民国来台湾之后，原本只是代表的角色，一来就会走了，大概是这个样子。美国人力也不足，日本人也不能久留，最后变成中华民国在台湾。那语言的部分，我们目前知道国语在台湾是一个最强势的语言，但是。 台湾还是可以推广多元语言的，其中教育是一个最好下手的地方。各级学校本来就可以开设各种多元语课程，甚至我觉得各级学校的考试，甚至大学联考在内，都应该要让学生挑一个母语来进行测验，可以是闽南语、客家语、原住民等等。基本上，我并不觉得这种事情实行起来会有多困难。而且，多重官方语言并不会消磨国家国族的意识，像瑞士就有4个官方语言。 瑞士的国族主义大概是全国最强的，超强的中文。那印度有19个官方语言，可是却没有因此让印度缺乏凝聚力。像印度最主要的语言是北印语，大概是在印度北部那个高原地带。那印度东部呢，还是有些零星的小语言。那英国上流社会跟政府官员比较喜欢用英语。那基本上，渐进这些例子之后，台湾其实也可以发展多重官方语言。
并且多多的在校园或在社会当中去推广国语以外的其他语言，甚至进行测验。Can I just say one more thing about language? There was going around in my head, and I was thinking, I want to say this, but you know what? I can't remember what it is. And that's this. Ireland, wonderful example. If you're English, of course, Ireland is like, you know, engraved on your heart. You know, it's the one part of the, you know, the United Kingdom that was lost, largely because of stupidity. Ireland is a very interesting example of a country where they have their own language. It's called Gaelic. Or of course Irish, if you prefer, and by probably the 1880s, 1890s, very, very few people spoke Gaelic. Very, very few people in Ireland at all. And one of the sort of great, at the end of the 19th century, so let's probably say from 1895 onwards, Ireland had this huge cultural campaign to create a nationalist identity for itself. To sort of, I mean, obviously a lot of Irish felt that they had an identity, but in some way it wasn't an identity that they could articulate. It just seemed to sort of go back to some mystic past that most people had forgotten about. They needed a modern identity. They needed a modern Irish identity. One of the things they did was to put a lot of effort into relearning Irish. Everybody spoke English. Very few people spoke Irish. But they decided, no, we've got to relearn Irish. This is our language, it's key to our identity. And they did so. And of course, in schools in Ireland today, you have to take exams in Irish, even though the vast majority of the people in their day-to-day lives still speak English. The point is not that there was a cultural transformation whereby Irish overtook English. That never happened. The point was that they stressed the importance of Irish as being important to the sense of themselves as being Irish people, right? I mean, everywhere you go in Ireland, all the signs are in the two languages, even though probably only 10% of Irish can actually carry on a conversation, a normal level of conversation in Irish, even though they were studying in schools. The point is, not that everybody speaks it, everybody thinks it's valuable, and that officially it's always used. Laws are written in Irish, treaties are written in Irish, even though people still use English. Irish is still, it's essential to their idea of who they are and what they are. And I think there's probably something, you know, useful to be learned about them. Incidentally, of course, one of the best multilingual environments that I know of is just outside here. It is the Taipei MRT, the JU, right? Where, of course, we have all the announcements in Mandarin, Hokkien, Hakka, and finally English for people like me. And I think, excellent. And actually, I don't have a problem if that was used all over Taiwan for everything. And I don't see how that could possibly weaken Taiwan's national identity. It could only strengthen it.
我想补充一点，就是爱尔兰的例子。其实对英国来讲，爱尔兰是一个痛，因为爱尔兰就是好像是从联合王国被割出去的一份。但是基本上呢，爱尔兰原本有个固有的语言叫做爱尔兰语，可是因为联合王国长期统治的关系，所以一直到19世纪末，爱尔兰全民都讲英文。然后呢，后来爱尔兰在1895年开始就发起了文化运动，进而开始寻找民族的认同。那一开始，爱尔兰他们只有久远的和爱尔兰的神话，他们觉得这样不够，想要找一些更现代的身份认同，因此他们都是想说，他们全民重新学自己的母语。他们拒绝接受现状，所以大家全民一起学爱尔兰语。所以你现在到爱尔兰去，你会发现各级学校都要考爱尔兰语。那虽然说大家都要读，都要考爱尔兰语，但是大家日常生活用的还是英文。所以重点来了，其实这种文化转型并没有因此让爱尔兰语取代英语的地位，他们只是拿这个语言来强调自己的身份认同而已。到处你去看爱尔兰街头的标示都是双语写的，但是呢，如果你去找任何爱尔兰人，请他们用爱尔兰语对话的话，大概只有10%的人能够顺畅的用爱尔兰语进行日常的对话。所以基本上，爱尔兰语在爱尔兰本身并没有那么普及，但是却受到非常大的珍视。在官方所有的文件都必须以英语跟爱尔兰语双语撰写，条约也是一样的。爱尔兰语对他们说是找出自己是谁的一个线索而已。那其实不用说看爱尔兰那么远的地方，台北捷运也是有四个语言的广播啊，国、闽、客、英嘛。那基本上这种四个语言的标示也可以扩及到台湾各个角落去，而且这么做绝对不会影响，绝对不会弱化台湾的民族认同。
那个说起语言的问题，我有简单的补充啊。我爸妈都是客家的，那这个台语和喉咙也是后来才学的，啊，完全是后来才学，因为我家完全不讲台语，我们的亲戚通通不都讲台语。但是呢，好，在我读高中的时候，好，那是1980年代末期，啊，在我读高中的时候，我们在学校哦，觉得讲台语很酷，我们当时都拼命的讲台语，因为为什么喜欢讲台语？因为哦。第一个，当时台湾在开始民主化，我们觉得讲台语很酷。好，第二个呢，讲台语的那些很喜欢管我们的老师跟教官听不太懂。好，所以呢，我的意思就是说，台湾也曾经有过这样子，让大家觉得说讲台语是一种认同啊，是一种很酷的情况。我们要做的是怎么让这样的事情能够恢复回来。好，那并不是我觉得那是一定可以做到的。后来我去当兵的时候，更不用讲了。那这个基本上全部都讲台语，啊，那这个
然后讲得很好的话，哦，啊，就会得到很高的认同。后来就慢慢习惯了，就一半一半。但是呢，我个人觉得，在台湾这个社会，哦，我认为说，对于以我个人的经验来讲，对于台语的普及，哦，我觉得现在来讲影响最大的可能不是国民党，哦，而是部分的台语族群。比如说我在公共场合讲台语的时候，哦，不止一次会被人纠正发音，哦，但是基本上来讲，我觉得被纠正发音的人，哦，像我脸皮这么厚还会继续讲的人不多。很多年轻人呢，他就不敢讲了，他就不敢讲。我认为这是一个非常严重的问题。好，哦，上个星期呢，我去主持客家电视台的一个节目。好，哦，那个这个有一位来宾，哦，啊，纠正了我两个字的客语发音，但是他几乎全程没有办法用客语发音，他完全用北京话发音。好，哦，为什么？因为他是要用这样子的方式，哦，去掩饰说他的客语其实不行，但是他的客语不行，严格讲也不是他的错。我认为说，哦，我们要摒弃这种过于谦卑的态度，啊，即使你讲得不好，啊，即使你只能一半讲一半，啊，大部分讲北京话，一部分讲台语，一部分讲客语，我认为都要勇敢讲。然后呢，对于这种，哦，喜欢纠正别人发音来显示自己语言优势的人，哦，我认为说呢，我们要用正确的态度去对待他。像刚才艾德先讲得很清楚，啊，爱尔兰，啊，基本上大部分人其实是不能用爱尔兰语对他的，但是呢，并没有因为这样就不推动爱尔兰，啊，也没有因为这样呢，啊，就去影响或者是去看不起那些只能少部分讲爱尔兰语。我认为这是一个正确的，啊，这个态度。不过呢，我也有点跟艾克先生的想法稍微有点不同，就是说在爱尔兰呢，讲爱尔兰语的人，啊，基本上这是认为是一个国族，啊，认同的象征。可是在台湾呢，有没有那个讲台语讲国话的族群是支持国民党的人？啊，这个比例非常高，啊，也就是说呢，在这个过程当中，啊，我们怎么样把这个语言，啊，跟国族，啊，做更紧密的认同，我觉得还需要有更多更多的努力。我的想法大概是这样。
这一点很重要，就是我们基本上不应该用那种本质化的这种角度来看待如何达成这个解殖民的这样一个共通的一个目标。请先放下，现在这一轮就回到主场，请这边一位陈嘉怡，主场优势的话，那第三位是燕姐，你看到了
没？没有，我没看。
第三位麻烦再重来，是一二三。哇塞，太难看，就是红衣服的先生，好不好？好，就第一题，这，然后第二个，加第三个红衣服先生。
大家好，事实上啊，我不太喜欢讲这个所有的普通话或者北京话，是这样子。我认为每一个族群都在哀嚎说他不受重视，尤其像山地原住民客家人，他们当然觉得是不受重视的。那台湾要独立之前，我觉得有个动作非常重要，就是说如果各族可以他在自己的领域里面，就是传统生活领域里面去做独立的动作，他就可以得到人家的尊重，可以去保护他自己的语言文化甚至文明。那台湾现在这样子的人少，他只是来认为别人歧视他，可是他没有做自己保护自己文化的动作，所以这是一个很可怜的事情。那另外一点，我要告诉各位，我是西拉雅族，我是平埔族，但是我不会讲这个我们西拉雅的话。事实上，西拉雅族的语言也被分了好几个 tribe， 所以这个就是很奇怪的一现象。那没有关系，我认为即使你忘了你的语言，都可以复育。像这个犹太人，他们回到以色列的时候，他们去复育，用小学生去学他们的犹太语，然后再回去教他的爸爸妈妈，甚至他的祖父祖母。哦 ，Why not？ 台湾如果说你要考大学，你可以在你的族群里面用你的族语去做一个考试的动作，那你就可以做到保护。 那这个之后，每一个族群都受到保护、受到尊重之后，你来再来做一个 Formosa Unit， 就是或者说 United States of Formosa。Why not？ 因为这个我们要做一个 approach 的动作，而不是在那边互相挑衅、互相叫嚣。OK， 这是一个。另外一个，我们今天的 speaker 说，我们为什么不 tell story？ 我们的故事难道很少吗？但是问题是我们的 media 在哪里？好，我这个因为这个蛮重要，所以我是不懂。我们的媒体都掌控在 KMT 的手上，这是我们要去 approach 去突破的地方。好，谢谢各位。
很高兴能够今天能够听到叶先生的演讲。那我有两个比较小而且比较基本的问题，比较粗浅，想要请艾大先生就是说明一下。就一开始你在对于殖民的定义讲的主要是以非本地本土的人发展成长出来的一个政治统治关系。那我想要问的是说，在您对殖民的定义里面，被统治者的同意这件事情对于殖民的状态是这两个东西之间的关系，是说是被统治者同意被统治所以这是殖民，还是被统治者不同意被统治所以这是殖民？因为我问这个问题是因为今年在春天的时候，网络上有过一场不小的辩论，有关于华独跟台独的问题。那那时候其实我想到说，不管怎么变，反正以后如果被统一了，那就不用变了，这样，因为就被殖民了这样。可是呢，如果在被殖民跟在殖民关系跟被统治者的同意之间的关系如果没有确认的话，我的想法或许有错，所以我希望艾律师能够说明一下。第二个是因为我们常常在讲说，这个国策老师也说了很多次了，在二次大战之后，世界的潮流是独立自主。那我很好奇一件事情是说，所以我们已经看到了很多殖民地独立了，少数没有被独立、没有独立的地方，可能台湾是一个这样。那关于殖民这件事情，现在目前的国际法是否还有任何的规范、讨论、界定？因为将来很可能，我们如果要很独立，我们是少数在喊说我们被殖民的地方。那如果国际法没有任何规范，那我们就又创了一次先例，又挑战全世界的认知。那如果有规范，我们现在也应该要知道。好，简单讲这样，谢谢。
第三位，
谢谢艾顿先生今天的演讲。我刚刚听了你这样子的，就是以上的演讲之后，我发觉你起码看到的是，起码有90%以上台湾人都没有注意到的问题。好，那我现在的问题就是说，我很认同你刚刚说，我们可以以说故事的方法来增进我们的土地认同、的族群认同。但目前台湾现在的问题就是有一些故事都被乱带风向，譬如说像郑南榕争取台湾独立，但是却会被民进党的一些立委简化成说，哦，那个郑南榕先生他是争取言论自由，然后他争取到了言论自由，我们要感谢他。又如之前台湾霸有一些关于228事件的争议，哎，然后台湾霸也是把228简化成台湾族群之间的斗争。那我们应该要如何？又如同今天像我们讲的是殖民主义与台湾。那也有一些人觉得说，我们现在可以选总统啊，我们现在怎么会是殖民呢？我们都已经有每个人一票，我们每个人都选票了，怎么还会是殖民状态？你也可以选民进党啊，自己不选的怪谁，对吧？就如的一些，也不能说它是谎言，但是它就是没有讲得很确切。就是只告诉你部分，然后再把一些风向乱带到其他地方。又如，有一些社运团体会说，会学着郑南榕先生说，我是叉叉叉，我主张台湾独立。嘿，但是这一些团体，就是他们又把一些事情给引导到其他的地方去，然后让我们就是想更了解台湾历史的人会不知所措。那我们应该如何打破这些半谎言？谢谢。
Let me think. I don't have much to add about the linguistic question. I think, as I said, I think everybody should learn a local language. They should probably be examined in it. It doesn't really matter whether they're proficient or not, but there should be some kind of effort to incorporate this as an idea of citizenship. The second, I'm sorry, what was the second question? I forgot the name. Yes. Well, I've always thought, actually, to be honest, I've always thought about media control. I've always thought that, basically, the question, how can you promote certain narratives? I've always thought that the Green Camp were pretty remiss about this, that they didn't really do a very good job. This is why I say they didn't read their ground sheet. If we're talking about this idea of narratives that I was talking about, this idea of stories, contending stories, the KMT understands this, or it did understand that very well, and it did a splendid job. And I don't see the same kind of organizational ability and determination in the Green Camp to sort of change things. I know that there's a desire, but somehow I don't feel that there's a means yet. I mean, as I said, as a matter of fact, just before I came out, I was looking for Formosa TV. And I said to my wife, so Formosa TV, there's a news channel, yes, and then there's another channel that has, you know, the usual soap operas and stuff like that. And I was talking to her about what the content of these soap operas was. And of course, it's exactly like everybody else's. And I thought, well, it's kind of a waste. You know, here's an opportunity to have some of the kind of narrative things that we were talking about. And it's an opportunity that at the moment's wasted. Something should be done about it. And finally, what was the third question? This is very, very long.
I guess it was my question. Was it?
Could be.
So the question is firstly about the definition of colonialism or colonial status.
Oh, well, yes.
Depending on the consent or disconsent of the government.
I'm tempted to say, it's kind of an interesting question, isn't it? And I'm thinking it's an interesting question because if you look at America, if you look at the American colonies in, say, the 1760s, they were actually very loyal. But of course, they were still colonies. If you look at them in 1776, they've suddenly become disloyal because of various quarrels about tax arrangements and stuff like that. So, yeah, I suppose there's absolutely no reason why you couldn't have there's no reason why you couldn't have a colony that actually had the consent of the governed, although, of course, it's worth pointing out that the American colonies had a very, very high degree of self-government. I mean, basically, they had their own colonial governments, and it was only in matters of transatlantic trade that Britain really sort of asserted its influence, and of course it's no accident that, for example, that one of the first acts of the American rebels was the Boston Tea Party, because of course transatlantic, the monopoly that was given to British shipping on transatlantic trade was a major point of controversy between the two. But I don't see really how that affects Taiwan. I mean, the Taiwanese, you could say Taiwan was a colonial society from 19, well, obviously it was a colonial society under the Japanese, but from the KMT takeover in the autumn of 1945 through to the early 90s, I'm not really sure that the consent of the governed was ever sought. Now, and we're not saying that it's a colonial society, what we are saying, I suppose, is that the narratives put forward by the KMT during their 40-year period of hegemony still exist and still influence people's thinking. And it's these narratives that we need to challenge and to find alternative narratives for.
Thank you.
那在媒体的描述部分呢，我想其实还是有很多努力的空间的。毕竟我刚刚讲的是说，其实媒体上面有非常多的故事跟描述。那这点其实国民党长期做的非常的彻底，经营的非常久。那目前绿营真正在做的就是要凝聚团结，组织起来。目前我看到有非常多这样的欲望，但是还没有感觉到具体的作为跟方法。像我出门之前才刚看过民视，民视有新闻台，也有戏剧，也有那种肥皂剧的另外的台。那我觉得另外连续剧的那个台比较可惜的一点，就是说它其实可以通过这种剧场的方式来提供更多的描述，而不是在讲很多就是民众一般日常生活中琐碎的事情而已。那在反观美国好了，就是我们再回到另外一个问题，就是到底受殖民者要不要同意这件事情。其实殖民的本质就是被殖民者本来就没有同意，他们也无权同意。像在美国1760年代的时候，你去看美国13州其实对英国是非常的忠诚的，而且有高度自治的殖民政府。但是到1770年却反了，主要是因为查耶税的问题。那基本上高度自治的美国13州政府只有一点没有自治，那就是跨大西洋的贸易方面完全由英国主宰，结果导致了非常大的税制争议，导致了整个13州的独立。那反观台湾，其实台湾一直都是一个殖民社会，尤其是从日治时代开始，然后后来日治时代结束了之后，变成国民党从1945年8月开始接手这个殖民政府。那1945年8月到1990年代初期，国民党长期的治理当中，也没有管过台湾到底同不同意被殖民呢？那基本上，就算1990年代之后台湾民主化了，40年以来所培养、所栽培的霸权文化，基本上还是存在的，而且一直影响着我们该做的就是去挑战这个文化霸权，找一个替代的描述。
时间也差不多了，我觉得我们应该
也要解放一下我们两位讲者，我们今天非常辛苦的这个即兴翻译家。我简单做个小小的一个结论哈，我就有谈解职或者谈所谓的追求台湾独立也好，我觉得我们都必须要认识到说目标一致，但是途径策略应该是要多重的。也就是说，我们不需要在朋友之间不断的用一种所谓的谁比谁纯正、谁比谁血统比较正统来区分出很多很多的那些敌人，这个我觉得是必须要放在心里面。那另外一点就是说，在追求解职的过程当中，我觉得我们应该把我们的思考、把我们的想象推得更远一点，解职打破旧的这个殖民体制的同时，也是要建立一个新的国家。所以我觉得我们应该去想象说，我们到底台湾应该是要建立一个什么样一个新的国家，就是说不是光只有推倒国民党的这个中统目标，还包括说包括性别平权，台湾的未来一个新的国家在性别平权上应该是有什么样的作为，土地正义、环保等等这些问题都是在走向这个解职的建立新的国家过程当中一些很重要的一些议题。那今天时间到这里差不多，非常谢谢各位朋友的热烈参与，掌声谢谢。